Good afternoon and welcome to our TV show featuring documentaries revealing the realities behind myths using research and scholarship. I'm your host Ergun Kırlıkovalı and I will be with you every Sunday at 4 p.m. Eastern Standard Time. You're welcome to send me your feedback at mythsandrealities.com. In episodes 63, 64, and 65, I shared with you a remarkable letter titled Strategically Mum, The Silence of Armenians, written by Iver Torikian, an honest Armenian truth seeker, wondering why there was so much misinformation about the Armenian-Turkish relations and why Armenian insurgents and the Turkish suffering they caused are hardly ever mentioned in Armenian writings. Why is that? The Center for Eurasian Studies, or AVIM by its Turkish acronym, a research group in Ankara, Turkey, published that letter in its August 2021 issue. Because of the sincere views presented with an academic objectivity and integrity. That letter triggered our discussion here of social concepts like propaganda, perception management, prejudice, and gaslighting, on one hand, and psychological concepts like groupthink, cognitive dissonance, and critical thinking, on the other. Today, I will finalize the analysis of the Torikian letter as I believe it addresses many of the key issues discussed in this TV documentary series. Torikian has come to realize that many Armenians are prejudiced, particularly towards Turks. A young Armenian cousin in Kinali Island in Turkey, near Istanbul, confessed to Torikian that the cousin hated all Turks. The wife of an old friend, Armenian friend of his dad in Paris, France, demanded that Torikian promise to her that Torikian would never marry a Turkish girl. Another Armenian cousin in Canada told Torikian that the cousin believed that Hitler did the right thing by trying to exterminate the Jews. It turned out that the cousin hated Jewish people as well as Turkish people. Throughout his life, Armenians have been kind to Torikian, including the people in these three incidents, which makes it very difficult for Torikian to understand how people can be simultaneously nice to him while hating people they have never met. How is that possible? Some Armenians want an apology from the Turkish government, while others reparations. Still others want the Turkish government to carve a large part of eastern Turkey and hand it over to Armenia on a gold platter. Such extreme demands, of course, are ludicrous for many reasons. Torikian does not support any part of the Armenian cause, as they all foster vindictiveness and hypocrisy towards Turks and Türkiye. Furthermore, Torikian believes demanding anything from the present generations of Turks, who had nothing to do with the events of a century ago, are ultimately harmful to all of humanity. Torikian thinks that few Armenians are willing to admit Armenian hate crimes and war crimes were committed by Armenians. Out of at least 1 million Armenians in Turkey before the World War I, writes Torikian, some immigrated to the US or Europe, and others remained in Turkey. Many of those took up arms for one side or another. Some were in the Ottoman army, others joined the Russian army either from the outset of the First World War or after deserting the Ottoman army. But most of the young Armenian men and some women, outside Istanbul, of course, joined one of the many Armenian militias and gangs marauding eastern Turkey. Torikian explains how the allegiances of Armenians were mixed. The wealthy Armenians in the cities were loyal to the Ottoman Empire, while others, mostly in rural areas, supported the Ottoman government but wanted reforms. Then there were those Armenians who opposed the Ottoman government no matter what and wanted an independent Armenia, Armenian state, carved out of the Ottoman Empire by force of arms. Torikian regrets that such complexity of the Ottoman Empire-Armenian relations were so poorly covered in Khachaturian's biased article in The New Yorker, which is representative of the writing by most Armenians. Torikian has often wondered why he has never seen photos of massacred Turks in Anatolia, Bulgaria, or Greece a century ago. Why is that? He thinks that the reason is bias. As cameras were owned mostly by Christians, and most Christians simply did not care about the Muslim suffering. That goes for the journalists covering the Middle East for Western newspapers. I covered this issue of the Turkish tragedy in the Balkans in episode 60. Nowadays, Armenians who are considered traitors by other Armenians are denounced and ostracized, not killed. Meline Toumani, an Armenian American, is one such person. She published a book titled There Was and There Was Not in the US in 2014. It recounted her experiences of moving to and living in Istanbul, and she wrote about Turkish people in a favorable way. For this, she was blasted in Armenian publications and online. Torikian found very few Armenian scholars who have written impartially about the Armenians of that era. One such scholar was Louise Nalbandian, who published the Armenian Revolutionary Movement book in 1963 and wrote on one page, page 171, that ARF program of 1892 officially sanctioned terrorism. Another honest scholar, Torikian thinks, is Ronald Grigor Suny. In his 1993 book, Looking Toward Ararat, Suny wrote, for instance, that the hunchbacks sought to use, quote, propaganda, agitation, and terror, unquote, in that order, to achieve their goals. He also noted that in the Caucasus during the 1890s, the principal victims of the Armenian terrorists were Armenians themselves. Suny is one of the very few Armenian academics to describe the violent Armenians of that era as Armenian terrorists. He uses that term, terrorists. Unfortunately, books written by even-handed Armenians are not widely read or discussed. Instead, sensationalistic and misleading books with occasional lies by Armenian writers are preferred. Torikian writes about an Armenian called Peter Balakian, who in 2003 published a book called The Burning Tigris, which got much praise from book critics. It was a difficult book to read for Torikian because of Balakian's intense anti-Turkish bias evident on nearly every page. Here's an example. I quote, "The nationalist stance against Armenia became increasingly virulent. Procrastination by the Entente in Paris gave the Turks the time they needed to invade Armenia," unquote. What comments does Balakian provide to demonstrate this virulence? None. Balakian often fails to substantiate the many claims he makes throughout his book. Torikian suggests that the second sentence boils down to twisting facts. Balakian says there was procrastination among the Allies regarding the nationalists' conflict with Armenia. That is false. There was no procrastination. The governments of Britain and France had simply become unwilling to fight the Turkish nationalists militarily. Instead, they sought to impose their will on Türkiye diplomatically. It did not work. As for Russia, the Bolsheviks never opposed the Turkish nationalists. On the contrary, they soon became allies. Torikian's biggest objection to the second sentence from Balakian's book lies not in what Balakian says, but what he leaves out. Balakian says that the Turkish Nationalist Army invaded Armenia. Technically, that may be correct. However, Balakian ignores the Armenians' acts, evil acts of aggression towards Turkey that was the root cause of that Turkish retaliation. Torikian reminds us that Balakian also neglected to mention that in 1918, the Turkish government gave thousands of tons of wheat to Armenia so that its inhabitants could survive their first winter in Armenia. We Armenians, Torikian says, repaid Turkey by invading Turkey in 1919 with the assistance of the French army, committing many atrocities. It was these massacres, not procrastination by the European governments, that compelled Ataturk's nationalist army to attack Armenia. But most Westerners, particularly Americans, are most apt to accept the tall tales of Balakian and other Armenians than to research the truth themselves. This is unfortunate and unfair to the people of Turkey. Armenians did other shameful things in 1919, Torikian writes. That year, the inhabitants of Armenia held a mass celebration to mark the first year of Armenia's existence, singing Mer Hayrenek, the Armenian national anthem. In 1919, the fourth stanza of the Armenian national anthem had the words, "Let Turkey be destroyed." Those lyrics have been replaced later by less inflammatory lyrics. But those words were there in the song in 1919 and for well over a decade thereafter. For many years, all Armenians who sang Armenia's national anthem implicitly called for the destruction of Turkey. Torikian notes that Balakian was either unaware of these facts or he simply ignored them. In a chapter on Van in 1915, Balakian says the following in his book. The Armenians were neither attempting to destroy the Turks or the Armenian Empire, nor attempting to secede, unquote. Many Armenians say that they were only defending themselves. Torikian disagrees. Many Armenian documents from that era do in fact show that many Armenians wanted secession from the Ottomans. As for not wanting to destroy the Turks or the Ottoman Empire, one merely must consider the lyrics of Mer Hayrenek, the national anthem of Armenia, to see the falseness of that argument. There are other major omissions in Balakian's book. The Dashnak's attempt to murder the Ottoman Sultan in Abdülhamid II in 1905 is one. Perhaps the most glaring example of willful omission on Balakian's part is his failure to mention Andranik Ozanian, a revered figure among the Armenians who commanded regiments in the Bulgarian army, the Russian army, or simply battalions of Armenians independently, killing many Turks, mostly defenseless Turkish villagers and farmers. Torikian has come to agree with many writers who have said that Ozanian's cruel acts are what led to the removal of Armenians from their towns and villages. Yet Balakian writes not a word about Ozanian, How is that possible? Turkish scholars have long argued that there is a bias in the Western media in favor of Armenians regarding the events of that era. Torikian has come to agree. Instead of getting a truthful account of what occurred in Turkey 100 years ago, most people in the English-speaking countries get one-sided articles like A Century of Silence and misleading books like The Burning Tigris. Along those same lines, Khachaturian and Balakian get rewarded and praised. In the edition of The Burning Tigris that Torikian has on his shelf, there are quotes excerpted from reviews of the book. One reviewer called it a thoughtful and thorough book. Really? Another called it encyclopedic. Yeah, right. A third one called it comprehensive. Torikian strongly disagrees with all three reviewers. Torikian believes that the Armenians have been nursing a grudge for so long that they cannot comprehend the contradictory facts. That is called cognitive dissonance in modern psychology. The possibility of Armenians being terrorists and backstabbing ingrates is just too much for the Armenians to accept. Instead, they are determined to continue repeating to the Armenians, to the non-Armenians, a simplistic false narrative about the events of a century ago and continue to make outlandish demands for compensation and territory. According to Meline Toumani, the focus of most social gatherings among Armenians in North America is the Armenian cause, which unifies the Armenians. The three most visible activities of Armenians, namely reiterating the misery endured, avoiding all discussion of Armenian wickedness, and demanding reparations and territory, are all inseparable. Torikian, however, cannot conform to the way that most Armenians think, talk, and behave, as he finds it stifling and dishonest. Armenians also demand from Turks today an apology. Torikian is troubled by apologizing for something that one's predecessors have done. He can apologize for things he did, his mistakes, of course, and even for the misbehavior of one's children. But apologies for what one's ancestors have done carries no weight or validity. Conversely, though, Torikian has never heard of any Armenians expressing any remorse for what Armenians did over a century ago. His mother once told him about a conversation she had many decades ago with an elderly Armenian man about the turmoil in Turkey in the early 20th century. I quote, "There was a lot of killing on both sides," unquote, he told her. It is what Torikian has been reading for 6 years, and yet nowhere, not in any document, on any website, nor in any book, has he seen any signs of remorse by an Armenian about what Armenians did during that era. Torikian feels ashamed about Armenian's silence, hence the letter's name. Torikian notes that most rebellions by Armenians occurred in Zeytun, in the southern part of central Turkey, about 125 kilometers from the Mediterranean Sea. It is now called Süleymanlı. Nalbandian says in the Armenian Revolutionary Movement that in 1628, Sultan Murat IV granted the inhabitants of Zeytun nearly complete independence, so long as the Zeytunlus paid their taxes. Despite this agreement, according to Nalbandian, the inhabitants of Zeytun fought perhaps as many as 57 battles against the Ottoman regime. These dozens of Zeytun rebellions, along with many other uprisings over the centuries within the Ottoman Empire, all deserve scholarly scrutiny. Some Armenians, like Peter Balakian, have argued that there were no uprisings by Armenians in the Ottoman Empire. Balakian and other Armenian writers insist that all acts of mass violence that the Armenians undertook long ago were entirely defensive in nature. They were defensive measures for survival. In the Burning Tigris, Balakian uses, as an example, the Kaza or district of Sasun. He arrives at conclusions which Torikian finds dubious. Sasun is in eastern Turkey, about 100 kilometers west of Lake Van. In 1894, there was violent conflict between the Armenians of Sasun and Ottoman soldiers. Kurds were also involved. They fought on the side of the Ottoman soldiers. Armenians have claimed that the violence was sparked by the unjustness of the double taxation imposed on Armenians. It seems that we Armenians were being forced to pay taxes both to the Ottoman government and to local Kurdish chieftains. Balakian says in the Burning Tigris that this double taxation was ruining the Armenian agrarian economy. He does not substantiate this. In the Armenian Revolutionary Movement, Nalbandian says that, at least in the case of one Armenian village, what the Kurdish chieftains demanded was commensurate with what the Armenian villagers were able to pay during that era. It is clear to Torikian that these payments demanded by the Kurds were unjust. However, Torikian has found no evidence that the payments demanded from the Armenian villagers were outlandishly high. The distinction between unfair taxation and unbearable taxation is important for deciding on the justification for violent action. While Balakian and others have argued that there were never any Armenian insurrections, but the oppression Armenians had to endure compelled Armenians to rebel. Other Armenian writers have contradicted this line of thinking, saying that Armenians did, in fact, revolt against the Ottoman Empire. A British colonel named Alfred Rawlinson, who wrote the book Adventures in the Near East, describes a meeting he had with three Armenian military commanders in Anatolia in 1919. He had heard about massacres carried out by Armenians against Muslims. He had confronted them with these charges. The commanders were unconcerned about the charges. They simply justified the killings by saying that massacres and atrocities of all kinds are inevitable in Anatolia. That's it. That's what they said. Torikian is still trying to piece together what happened. One of the books on his shelf, a 1995 reference book titled Dictionary of the First World War, states on page 34 that Armenians killed 120,000 non-Armenians in 1914. As Torikian has pointed out, as it has become increasingly difficult nowadays to conceal or ignore the violence that Armenians carried out during that era, many Armenians like Balakian have begun to insist that all acts of Armenian violence were in self-defense. However, this self-defense argument does not explain all the accounts of Armenians' killing of the non-combatant Turkish or Kurdish tribes. In 1923, the first Prime Minister of Armenia, Ovanes Kachaznuni, published a booklet titled Dashnak Sutyun Has Nothing to Do Anymore. There, Kachaznuni says that Armenians had been foolish in trusting European powers and thinking that Armenians could establish a large Armenian state in Anatolia. Kachaznuni even suggests that removing Armenians out of Anatolia was the logical thing for the Ottoman government to do in response to the foolhardy plans of the Hunchaks and the Dashnaks. However, even Kachaznuni doesn't express any regret for the blood Armenians recklessly spilled during that era. No remorse. He just says that Armenians had been foolish. In closing, Torikian feels ashamed that no Armenian has had the integrity and the courage to step forward and say, yes, Armenians helped the Russian army invade Turkey. And yes, we Armenians killed thousands of Ottoman soldiers and women and children, as well as innocent farmers too. We committed crimes against humanity. Unquote. It burns Torikian's fingers to type these words, but he feels that it is a disgrace that most Armenians around the world refuse to acknowledge the outrages that Armenians have committed against tens of thousands of people in Turkey over a century ago. This concludes the four-part series on the coverage of Torikian's soul-searching and honest letter. When more Armenians show the courage to step forward, to join Torikian and handle the bitter truth, there will be a civilized dialogue between Turks and Armenians, which I'm certain will eventually lead to peace and closure. Until then, my work continues. Thank you for joining me, and see you next week.